And after all, it's all about being incremental in the way that you're improving. So the aim or the goal is not to be agile, it's to improve.
That is Ines Garcia, an Agile coach and author of a book on using Agile with Salesforce. I'm Josh Burke, your host for the Salesforce Developer Podcast. And here on the podcast, you'll hear stories and insights from developers for developers. Today, we sit down and talk with Ines about Agile, using it with Salesforce, and the book and the games that she has made. And as usual, we start off with the early years.
I study communications, and towards the end of my degree, I was already working as PR for Segway Catalonia. And part of the job, it was convincing politicians to basically jump into this thing to have some kind of media exposure. And well, they go on holidays over summer. So I spoke with my boss and I said, listen, I think I'm going to go to London for a month because there's no one here to convince. And so I did. And what happened is that, you know, a different country, a lot of things. I absolutely loved it. And 3 weeks in, I called back and I said, I'm not going back.
How did your boss react to that?
Well, I tried to get somebody else that could take over and, and things like that. But, you know, life takes you to interesting paths. So you just need to make the most out of it, I guess.
Nice. And where were you from originally?
So I'm from Barcelona.
Gotcha. So almost just kind of as a side question, because I, too, love London and I just love visiting there. But what are some of your favorite things about the city?
Well, I love that it has so many flavors. So you could be walking and within three streets is a completely different space. And it's an ever-changing city. There is always something going on. Maybe this year not the most, but it's ever-changing. There is a lot of things and you get to meet people from all over. It's, I find that really rich.
Nice. And then how did coming to London land you into an ecosystem of software engineering?
So, well, at the beginning, I did all sorts of jobs. You know, I was still paying my flat here, my flat over there. So sometimes I will take the first plane in the morning, come back with the last one at night because I was presenting my final project in the university. And over time, I kind of got back to communications, more in the internal side, such as business transformation. And, you know, digital solutions have a lot to do with it as an enabler. By themselves, they don't do anything. But yeah, this kind of took me through that path. And in one of the companies I was working for, the CEO said, you know, I kind of leave you guys the decision about the CRM roadmap. But one thing I'm telling you, and we are going to get Salesforce. And so, we just look at each other and we didn't know what we were selling now.
So that was kind of my next question. So you kind of got introduced. You're one of these people who sort of got introduced into the Salesforce ecosystem because the company you're working with is like, here's Salesforce, learn it, figure out, tell us what you think.
Yeah, in a sense. And to be honest, I was quite drawn to it. I really like to understand how things work. And so, you know, in my own time, I like spin a dev org, you know, we had this, I actually really enjoy it. We had this 700 pages workbook fundamentals that takes you through a very long use case and you get to know the platform more. And I loved the concept of citizen development. It really blew my mind. It comes with its dangers, as we all know. But it really blew my mind that I could be doing things to make other people's life better.
How would you define citizen development?
The ability to configure business flows that support the vision of the different themes of value that company is trying to achieve.
Nice. And like your early days working with Salesforce, you weren't really like Agile was not something that was first and foremost to your mind, right?
I kind of got to know the two more or less at the same time. So I'm someone that likes to read a lot and is really interested, especially in the kind of business transformation world transformation is such a heavy word, but the kind of work that I was doing is important to know how change and resistance to change affects in an organization, and what the different things and system thinking that you should be having to enhance everybody's life rather than make them worse, right? And over that reading and that investigation is where I came about all these agile concepts.
Gotcha. And did you have like a moment in your career which just sort of cemented that you're like, agile's the path for me?
I think that the concepts were really interesting, and I would try to make my own spin of it without really understanding the roots and the principles lying behind. So I will make my daily stand-up twice a week with my team and, you know, some other random things. Not very daily and not very standing either. And yeah, and then so I decided, because it was really attracting, but something wasn't quite fermenting in the way that I thought it should be.
Yeah.
Then I decided to embark myself into the Scrum path. So going through the several different certifications, and you need to submit work experience and different things to go through the path.
Gotcha. Gotcha. I think that's interesting. And I feel like a lot of people end up approaching Agile in that manner. Like I feel like I've done Agile in like 13 different ways. And it's like, it's always like kind of what fits into the team structure and the timetable. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah. And after all, it's all about being incremental in the way that you're improving. So the aim or the goal is not to be agile, it's to improve.
Right, right. Well, okay, so let's level set for everybody on what we're talking about, what Agile means. Like, describe to me what the Agile Manifesto is.
Well, the Agile Manifesto is something that a bunch of guys 20 years ago came about with. But yeah, so the manifesto itself, it kind of surfaced from a group of software engineers that they were already doing things differently. And they decide to keep their discrepancies aside, to kind of go together for a weekend on a ski resort, I'm sure, drinking and skiing and chatting, among other things, and come together to define what were the things that was working for them in their different approaches that they were making, was making their life on delivering software better. Mm-hmm. And so there you go, manifesto is there, with four values, 12 principles, and lot of stories.
We probably don't have time to get into the 12 principles, but what are the four values?
So the four values, actually, I really like, because it's like a grade. You generally see this kind of theoretical values as a list of adjectives or so. Mm-hmm. But instead, the Agile Manifesto tell us values within context. So it values more individuals and interactions over processes and tools. So it's not that we don't have processes, we don't use tools. Of course we do, but where the value lies is more in those interactions and the individuals involved. Mm. The second one is working software, or you could be saying working product, is value more over comprehensive documentation, state docs that takes forever and no one reads, where the value is there. Mm. Of course we document, but we'll approach it differently. Mm-hmm. It values more customer collaboration over contract renegotiation. And it values more responding to change over following a plan.
Gotcha. And you have gone so far as to become a certified Scrum Master. What was that process like?
So as I mentioned earlier, it's kind of like a path. So you can sign up in the scrumalliance.org. I'm a member. I try to be involved as well. And you sit there for 2 days. And at the end of it, you pass an exam and you can call yourself a Scrum Master. Yet I would argue you don't master nothing after 2 days of a course. But it gives you some kind of foundation of this this framework, which is highly, highly used in the world. To kind of, the way that I describe this Scrum framework is like, it helps you to get into a rhythm. A rhythm and pauses, you know, because music is not only what you hear, but it's also the pauses in between. And it helps you to get that rhythm so that you can be focusing to deliver that value earlier, right? So that comes having the principles of that constant delivery of whichever product you're doing, valuing those individuals and interactions, you know, that working end product, that's where the value lies, and so on. It gives you that rhythm.
And actually, give me a little more detail about that. Like compare that to, and I'm kind of putting this in quotes now because I feel like calling waterfall traditional is I think some people wonder how much of a tradition it is at this point. But like that concept of delivering value earlier, how is that an improvement over waterfall? And how does it kind of like maybe abate some of the risks in software delivery?
So, yeah, exactly. Waterfall is probably the most used thing as a traditional or right. olden days to look right. at projects. And that goes this way. It's a cascade of events where at the beginning of the project, you're going to spend a certain amount of a phase gathering requirements. After that, you will wrap that up and you will hand this over to probably a high level design. Mm-hmm. And then you have this other phase, and then probably you do another wrap up and hand over to somebody else or another team that's going to be hopefully by that point start touching the product. And then after that, you may have an integration phase. And then after that, you may hopefully get to the testing phase. And so it's a cascade of events, very sequential and very defined what is gets done on that particular amount of time. Mm-hmm. And so the flow in that system is that at the beginning of the project is when you know the least that you are ever going to know about the thing that you want to get out the door. Mm-hmm. So why on earth are we putting ourselves in a pickle when, I'm sorry, but we cannot foresee the future? And I think this year is a great example. Mm-hmm. So we need to resist less to change because change is part of nature. And so how we react for our environment changes, for our tech changes, for our team changes, for, you know, we are surrounded by change. So let's make the most out of it instead mm-hmm. of fighting against that.
Nice. So talking about some specifics about Agile, how would you define extreme programming?
Right. So extreme programming, I think for me, it would be like a practice that you put on top of your Agile mindset. And it gives you a little bit more specific things to do that perhaps the mindset itself or the frameworks are trying to stay away from.
Gotcha. And tell me a little bit more. So you're talking about waterfall having these kind of long aspects of time and planning and things like that. Talk to me a little bit more specifically about like how Agile is breaking down time when it comes to things like sprints.
Exactly. You just said that sprint is like the biggest time box that you have. And mm-hmm. what the time box is there to do is to help us to bring down uncertainty and increase agreement. So we have a certain amount of time that we give ourselves a goal to accomplish. And so instead of having those phases we were talking that we'll hand over and decide things up front, what we do is a mm-hmm. smaller scale where we can do everything and we're doing it together.
Mm-hmm. And in your book, you say a scrum is simple to understand but difficult to master. What exactly do you mean there?
So scrum, it gives you that rhythm. It will give you certain ceremonies that as a team, you kind of come together towards that common mm-hmm. goal. The difficulty that I've seen is that you can easily get through the motions without the emotions. And so it misses the point of just sit there and wait or expect somebody to tell you what to do. And then every day you give a status report. And at the end, you just sit in a boring meeting, people moaning. And then you do it again. And that's, for me, is missing the point of each one of those things. So I think it's very simple when you explain Scrum. I think people get it, but it's a muscle that you need to train.
So what would you define as values of a good Scrum meeting?
Depends on the one that we're talking about. But even if we sprinkle some XP on top, each one of them needs the whole team. You need to do it collaboratively. So, you know, mm-hmm. you have certain concepts of pair programming, for example, from XP. So how can you embed those things so you can increase your team knowledge and you can enhance whichever thing that you are building? So it's not silos and it's not handovers. So, you know, how you have that concept of whole team within each one of them.
Gotcha. And what's like, if I'm sitting in a scrum, what should like a good takeaway for me be from that meeting?
So if, for example, we are talking about the planning, so as a team, you should have a clarity and you should have been part of building the common goal for that week. So you know where you're going. You may not have all the specifics of the world for detail, absolutely everything, but you know where right. you're going and you have enough to start with.
Gotcha. Tell me a little bit more about like the concept of time boxing and how is that being used to be more efficient?
So time is an invented concept. Okay. Without going to meta. So if we think that we live in a ever-changing environment, to be able to bring down or increase certainty of what's going on, what we can do is to reduce time.
Gotcha.
So let's say if I look at what am I going to do next month, I can have a rough idea. Most likely things going to change, so things will fluctuate. But if I look what I'm going to do now until the end of the day, it's probably much more accurate. And because humans, we are terrible and are planning far away or seeing far away.
Right, right. So in a lot of ways, by reducing things down to distinct units of time, you're reducing risk because you're only dealing with the things that you can kind of accurately predict, so to speak.
Yeah, and you reduce uncertainty and you bring agreement because sometimes, most of the times, there is more than one way to achieve something. So having a small amount of time to tackle something gives you reassurance and gives you the ability to spin a prototype or to try something new, you know, new piece of tech or whatever it is, and have a play with it and have more information. So your decisions are more informed. And the best of all is that ideally in a small time amount of, in a small time frame, you can put something out there, test it out. Your users like it, your customers buy it. If it works, great, put more effort. If it doesn't, stop it.
Well, that kind of brings me to the next question I was going to say, because when I was reading your book, I thought it was interesting how feedback and communication comes up in different ways. For instance, the concept of using something like an MVP simply to prove a point, not to prove a product, if I'm saying that correctly.
I think in general, not only in the Salesforce world, but across as humans in our life, we should try to implement the scientific method to life, right? So scientists more often than not create hypotheses and then have statements that support the multiple statements per hypothesis. And then they will go and test to try to prove themselves wrong. And so is that way of thinking that we don't know what we don't know. So what is the bare minimum we can put out there to guide us? And ultimately is to reduce waste. It's not only waste of time or waste of money, but it's waste of energy of everybody involved.
Nice. And in talking about feedback loops, can you describe what shifting left to me means?
Right. So when we were talking about the sequence of events of waterfall, what happened is that as you only start touching the product quite late, or even doing the integration phase quite late, or even the quality assurance, well, unfortunately, the very last thing of all, as you discover new things, because this is going to happen, you just push key deliverables such as testing or quality assurance towards the end. And if we were looking at the graph, it kind of makes a bombshell effect, which the name, it kind of tells you, that.
What to expect, exactly.
That explodes once you go to production. So shifting left is completely the opposite. It's how can you reduce waste, and again, multiple type of waste, by thinking of that quality throughout your process. And this is also because if you ask me what I did 2 weeks ago, I'm going to have a rough idea, but not specific. You know, there is so much things going on and I push a lot of different things. Right. So for me to fix something or enhance something that I did 2 weeks ago or worse, because some of the waterfall projects are months, things that I did months ago, it takes me much more time, because most of what we do is conceptual, is creative. One will help. So it's very, as longer the time it goes from you doing something to having to revise it, the most expensive it's going to be to revise it.
Gotcha. And I kind of just love how everything that you just said, I feel like has special meaning in the year 2020. Because it's very difficult for me right now to think about what I was doing two weeks ago, to be quite honest. To kind of wrap that back around, especially to, you know, some of the agile values that you were talking about, when it comes to this kind of communication and feedback loop, what is Agile's perspective on documentation? Kind of like, how specifically is that rolled into a project?
So we think that we value more the working whatever thing we're doing versus boring papers. Yet we want to be able to reference things because we forget, we just talk about it. That's okay. So is, how can you approach documenting something in a way that doesn't drain everybody, especially it doesn't drain the product? So in the book, I basically cover one of the ways I've seen working quite well, but what you're trying to do is to have something which is slightly more high level in certain areas, that is information that can be disseminated across the organization, but also how you can share that knowledge across the team. So we were talking about not having only one person maybe dealing with a specific part of an integration or something like that. So, you know, having a T-shaped team that you can help each other, you know, peer reviews or pair programming and things like that really helps there as well.
Gotcha. And do you feel that Salesforce itself creates any special advantages or disadvantages when it comes to operating with Agile?
I think Salesforce is a great example. I normally quote them as an example. In 2006, you guys moved the engineering teams from more traditional ways to look at delivering value to Agile, and only with that move, you increase productivity by 38%, and the major releases that we love, they were wrapped up 60% faster. This is big numbers.
It's big numbers, and I have definitely heard internally that without that shift, there's like the 3RR would not happen. There was a philosophical shift that had to occur in order to get that rate of production actually up and running.
Yeah, and as a consumer, the other end from the wonders that this brings is we have so many new things coming up, and it kind of keeps us in our toes, so that we need to know, you know, all these new things that are being enhanced in the platform. For me, in a way, is that Salesforce is kind of helping us to push us to keep us in our toes, to try new things, to, you know, constantly refine, and, you know, to waste less effort, to waste less resources.
Right. Because if there's anything true about the Salesforce platform, and I remember telling my developers this all the time, is that, kind of going back to that 2 weeks thing, like you can't trust that the solution you did 2 weeks or 2 months ago is the right solution, because you don't know what new feature just rolled out in the spring release. And maybe that apex function just took out 10 lines of code that you used to rely on.
Yeah. And not only on, you know, maybe some destructive things that you may need to revise, but also you may be consuming more DMLs that you necessarily have, because some of the changes, it gives you the ability to bundle things. So, you know, it's important to keep up to date. As we say, things change constantly, and it's good to be in this ecosystem that you are basically reminded very often that there's better ways to refine your product.
Right, right. So I do want to talk about your book and like how and why it was written, but I'm kind of hoping if somebody's listening to this right now and they're hearing things like reduced risk and faster delivery and more production time, that maybe they're like, oh, I need Agile in my life. What starting points would you recommend? Like, are there good resources for somebody who's maybe been entrenched in waterfall, like for years of software development, that you would point them to?
We have a world of over information, so you can you can just Google it. We also did a session with Don Robbins, which is available in Pluralsight from his Salesforce Play-by-Play series. The series are fantastic, mm-hmm. and I was just so happy to give him the opportunity. So we did one just on Agile. It's going to give you some flavors of the basics, going through the principles, talking a little bit of Scrum, and tiny sprinkle of anti-patterns to be careful with at the end. So that may be a good one. Gotcha. And you can get a free trial and stuff. So it's kind of free over there. And obviously you have Trailhead, and there are some modules over there you can also do.
Right. Are there some book titles that are your favorites? Or is that too many to list?
Too many to list. There is one very interesting that I don't know why it's taking me so long to read. It's called XP and Scrum from the Trenches.
Okay.
The book was written on a weekend, apparently, and I love it that it has like the second version, which is the author looking back on time, like I can't remember how many years in between, and making mm-hmm. his director comments of, why did I say this? I actually think this now. Or, yes, I was so right. And it's really good. It's like super tangible what happened for him and his team, and what did they learn in the process of using Scrum and certain XP techniques. And that one is really good.
Nice.
There is another book called Scrum, The Art of Maximizing the Work Not Done or Deliver Double in Half of the Time. And is written by one of the authors of the Scrum Guide, and is really, really easy to read. And what I love the most is towards the end, you have stories, non-software related stories of how Scrum is applied to schools or to many other industries. I just find it fascinating.
Nice. Okay, so back to your own book. When did you decide you wanted to write it?
So this book has been in my mind for a good couple years. I need to do this thing. And, you know, procrastination is a thing. And at the beginning of this year, actually, I went to Japan Dreaming. And I love Japan. It was my third time there. And I said, you know what? So I'm there. I'm just going to take a month off and travel around a little bit, which is wonderful in so many ways. Also, extremely lucky to be rambling about at the beginning of this year, really, in ways that I couldn't.
Yes, good timing.
Yeah, I couldn't imagine. And so having some headspace, things bubbled mm-hmm. up. And one of the things was the book now. And I sort of told to myself that I should do what I preach. So as soon as I hit London, I gave myself a target every week. I had something specific that I was aiming towards. And yeah, a few months later, the manuscript was ready. And, nice. You know, and then at the end, you know, some things happened. I had to learn a lot of the things of KDP and print on demand and all these other things. But yeah, it's all about giving yourself some time boxes and commit to them.
So just as a side note, I feel like traveling is a little dangerous for you because you keep having big life things that happen after you go to places.
I love travel.
And I think you just touched on it a little bit there, but would you say that you used Agile to write a book about Agile?
Yeah, I do mention that in the book also. And mm-hmm. I even did that in a similar situation for the game car that I launched last year. Similar mm-hmm. situation, back of my mind, thinking about it. Yeah, I should do this thing. And then don't do anything about it. Instead, help myself, you know, slice the thing in manageable bites. Helping, you know, having progress towards it. As humans, it's important to pause and celebrate achievements and tiny wins. And I think, you know, there is a lot more to the mindset and the frameworks and all of that and why that works.
Yes. A mutual friend of ours, Mary Scotton, and I share a habit of effectively just putting things on a whiteboard, mostly just so that we can check them off. Like, it's not even an organizational tool as much as it is a miniature victory lap tool. And it confuses people all the time because my whiteboard's behind me in meetings. They're like, oh, what are you doing back there? And I'm like, just checking things off. Like, half the stuff that you see back here is stuff that's already been done. So both the book and the game have some lovely illustrations in them. And talk to me a little bit about the process of actually not just writing a book, but designing a book and then like getting those illustrations woven into it.
So about the card game, the illustrations are made by my wife, which made everything more tense, but lovely. And so it's someone very creative. And, you know, I was playing around with Google drawings or something ridiculous. You know, you have the tools that you have. And so, yeah, and the card game, just to bring some flavor, is called Birds, mm-hmm. Nerds, and Turds. And you're going to have illustration of these three different things. Mm-hmm. And as part of trying what works and not, we spin some kind of feedback forms, and we ask different people, because each one of them, it will mean something different, no? And with the feedback, it helps us to refine the illustration. So, for example, the birds. Having birds that are very neutral looking is extremely difficult. The beak makes them smiley. So, you know, that's the kind of feedback that you get. And, you know, you try to adapt with different things.
Nice. And also, as a side note, I can deeply appreciate having a very sophisticated feedback loop if you're having a project with your wife. That seems like that seems like a good time to have a nice tenet of Agile there. Okay, so Birds, Nerds, and Turds. Walk me through like a round of that game, and how would it play into, you know, improving my team and my project?
So the game itself has these three things I mentioned earlier, and then mm-hmm. it also has some statements. How one of the things in the Scrum framework is that pause to think how we done and what we're going to try next time in terms of process, not the product. And we so focus in the what we are delivering that sometimes we forget the how, which can have a massive difference. And when we were talking about going through the motions without the motions, is extremely dangerous to what's called a retrospective, that pause at the end of your mm-hmm. cycle with your team. Like those meetings can be so draining. And yes. Life is too important to just waste it like that. So
yes.
I always try to invent things, and I love games. I'm a big gamer, board games and all sorts. and I try to bring things that brings the energy up and helps all the voices to be heard. So that's essentially what I have tried to achieve with the game. You guys will have to tell me. So as I'm a gamer as well, the game has four different ways that you can play. But let's imagine the way number one, you will have mm-hmm. one of each. So one bear, one nerd, and one turd. Everybody of the team mm-hmm. will have one of each. Mm-hmm. And we have those statements. So quickly, we'll turn that statement in the middle or show it to the screen. And quickly, everybody will choose what do they think that as a team that statement matches to. And I have tried to write the statements in a funny way. So if we're talking about the, having the right support that we need at hand and on time, uh-huh. and everybody or majority are showing a third, well, it's surfacing a common understanding that there is something to improve then.
Gotcha.
And because everybody's gotcha. Voting at the same time, you know, we try to avoid groupthink, or some people are more outspoken than others, you know, it's giving the opportunity for everybody, similar to planning poker on that sense, right? So everybody votes mm-hmm, at the same mm-hmm. time.
Yeah. That interestingly brings me back to the interview I did with Andrew Davis, because he was talking about DevOps, and he's talking about like a passionate retrospective. And it feels like what you're doing is you're adding in a layer of fun that allows people to have a quasi-emotional experience with a meeting that almost everybody assumes is probably going to be painful from the onset.
Yeah, unless you've been in my teams and I make you play games. But after all, you know, you have a bunch of people that means well and, you know, stand up from their bed every morning to achieve something, mm-hmm. right? So right. how can you focus into becoming better at what we do? You know, and that can be right. fun, and that has to be rich and challenging and, you know, thriving. That's the energy that is worth to be sitting in the meeting for.
And that's our show. Now, before we go, I did ask after Ines's favorite non-technical hobby. And for somebody who tries to make her scrums fun with entertaining games, it really wasn't a surprise.
Board games. I love board games.
What's your favorite board game?
That's such a tough question.
I know.
I really like collaborative games. It seems a bit controversial, but there is one quite high street that maybe people knows about. It's called Pandemic. And everybody is playing together. So you all win or you all lose. And you have like seven right. different types to lose and only one type to win. And it's hard, but it's really good. I really like that.
I totally appreciate that. It's one of my favorites as well. One of the reasons it's my favorites is I feel like every time new players get into Pandemic, chances are that board is going to lose. But at the end of the game, everybody's like, oh, I know how we could have worked together better. Like it's like a learning process. And at the moment, even though you lost, you're like, I learned how to play this game better. So the next time we do this, like our chances of success have actually gone up.
Yeah, it's quite addictive. I remember a couple Christmas ago, we were playing it and we're like, another one.
I can definitely recommend Pandemic, especially for people who have had the year that we just had. I want to thank Ines for the great conversation and information. And as always, I want to thank you for listening. If you want to learn more about this podcast, head on over to developer.salesforce.com/podcast, where you can hear old episodes, see the show notes, and have links to your favorite podcast service. Thanks again, and I'll talk to you next week.